Teyssier as our speaker and guest. So Romain has did his PhD in astrophysics at CA in Saclay in 1996, and then went for a postdoctoral position Lawrence Livermore Laboratory in the United States. And then in 1998 he came back to Saclay. And then in 2009-2010 spent a visiting professorship in Zurich. And in 2013 he came permanently to Zurich. He's now a professor, he's there, professor of computational astrophysics. So he's very well known. Many people. He's the author of the famous Ramses code for hydrodynamics with the depth mesh refinement. So I guess most of you know Romain and are very curious to hear what he's going to talk about. So let's welcome him here to Heidelberg and looking forward to the talk. Thank you.
Very happy to be here, so I'm sorry for the game, but I will try to wrap up before it starts. This is my team, all my PhD students here, first line, doing all the work, and all the postdocs which are looking for jobs. I want to associate my team with my work. Today I will try to explore various scales and various challenges in computational cosmology and their transformation, starting with the very largest scale, which is the universe as a whole. And here the question we can ask is how accurate can we be in predicting the dynamical evolution of the universe within computer simulations? And one of the issues is obviously to understand galaxy formation, so it's a tricky problem which is dominated by the unknown processes which we usually call feedback processes. And I will mention two feedback processes, namely supernovae at small scales and radiation feedback at large scales. And then I will present you some first results we have obtained using radiation hydrodynamics of an entire galaxy. And then, if I have time, I will go back to cosmological scales to study the effect of binary physics. So that's the general context of my talk today, which is the universe as a whole. So everything starts after the recombination, the end of the ionized phase of the universe, followed by the dark ages. And then, after almost 1 giga-year, the first stars are forming and we witness what we call the cosmic reionization, where the universe is reionized again. And that's the beginning of a long era of galaxy formation, where first we form small galaxies down to larger galaxies today. And all this is within an expanding universe, and one of the key questions we are asking today is why is the accelerated expansion, why do we have an accelerated expansion in the universe, and the so-called dark energy problem. So the initial condition we are using here are very, very accurate. And that's a measurement of the fluctuation of the CMB on the sky. And you see that the red line is the model we are using, it's a lambda CDM model, which assumes that we have dark matter, dark energy, and only a tiny proportion of ordinary matter, which are matter which they are all made of. And you see that the accuracy of this model is very, very high, with a few glitches here that we decide to ignore. And so the knowledge we have of the initial condition are very, very good. So we start from a very well-posed set of initial conditions, and our goal now is to use a physical model for the universe, which is mainly a collisionless field, dark matter, and gravitational instability, which will structure the universe. As you can see here from a simulation that Volker has performed many years ago, compared to the actual distribution of galaxies around us, where you see each blue dot is a galaxy and each red dot is a galaxy that we have put inside each dark matter halo. And so you see the agreement is spectacular. The texture of this matter distribution is reproduced, which is far from easy. I think we have a very successful model here. One of the big unknown is how can we form galaxies inside the halos that have the right property. So now, one of the challenges, one of the frontiers we have to face is to go towards very high accuracy. in describing this dark matter dynamics in the universe. And so what you show here plotted is the ratio of the power spectrum of the matter fluctuation as a function of spatial scales between three different codes, three different n-body codes. So I used as a reference Frances, which is my code, the one giving the talk today, and compared to Gadget here, behind this dark cloud, and Piketty Graph, which is a true code. So those codes are very different, they have very different properties, but you see that they agree within 1%, which is this dark gray band here, at scales which are mildly nonlinear scales, here around 1 h over megaparsec. And if we want to understand the nature of dark energy using large-scale galaxy survey acutely, what we need to do is to have an accuracy for this n-body simulation, which is better than 1%, all the way up to a scale of 10. And so clearly, we are not there yet. We are close, but we are not there yet. And so that's one of the challenges we have to face, to describe the dark matter dynamics with this 1% accuracy. So as you will see later, there is another challenge, which is to understand the physics of baryons. And so, the physics of baryons means to understand galaxy formation. That's a big challenge. And the main problem we have to face is symbolized or is described by this curve, which is the stellar to halo mass fraction. So, as a function of halo mass, which is here, you have the fraction of stars, the stellar mass of stars in the central galaxy divided by the halo mass. And so, if the star formation efficiency would be uniform and high, you should have a flat curve everywhere. But obviously, what we see in the universe is far from being uniform. You have a peak of efficiency around the Milky Way size halo. And then, at the small mass end, the efficiency drops. So it's very inefficient star formation in dwarf galaxies, and very inefficient star formation in giant galacticos. And the peak of the efficiency at the Milky Way scale is actually also very, very low. That's one of the key issues. It's 20% efficiency, so why is star formation so inefficient? It's still a puzzle. And so of course we have a theory for that. First, supernova feedback is supposed to regulate this inefficient star formation in small galaxies. For the Milky Way, it's not clear. Supernova is probably efficient, probably not. So there is an idea that a lot of people are pushing forward to use radiation, to UV radiation for massive stars. So we'll see how it works. And then, on large scales, our theory is actually to use AGNV. So many, many groups are testing those ideas, and with mixed success. Mixed success means some are very successful, but sometimes it doesn't work. So I will go through these various scales, probably not in a lot of details, but I will show you some examples of achievements that cosmological simulations can provide. So the first scale is the scale of dwarf galaxies. So dwarf galaxies are very small mass halos, say 10 to the 10. And here, supernova feedback works very well at recycling the gas and controlling star formation. So here you have an example of the gas distribution of a small galaxy seen face-on and side-on. And you see that the gas is very turbulent, with a lot of fontaine flow recycling the gas up and down here. It's very structured. And the gas disk is very thick, very turbulent. The star formation rate that you see in this simulation is very bursty, with a high star formation episode immediately followed because of supernova explosions by the star formation going down, so a very quiet phase, and then the gas is falling back into the galaxy, creating another burst and so on and so forth. And so this burst, successive burst, or if you want, this breathing mode, have a strong effect on the morphology of the galaxy in striking agreement with observed nearby dwarfs. But they have also a very strong effect on the dark matter distribution. And that's one of the baryonic effects that we are looking for. And you see this simulation that we have performed a couple of years ago, where it's a controlled simulation of an isolated halo, where we cool the gas and form these supernova-driven galactic outflows. And the effect of this repeated burst is to create a core, a very significant core distribution of dark matter of around 1 kpc in the inner region, which seems to be in agreement with what is observed in nearby dwarfs. So there is a lot of controversy because measuring those diameter properties of dwarf galaxies is a very tricky business. But here we have this nice mechanism which explains the formation of the core inside an otherwise cusped profile. So this, the effect of supernova feedback is clearly to modify the dark matter and the mass distribution as a whole. So now I want to look at the second prediction due to supernova feedback, which is the growth of magnetic field inside the dwarf galaxies. So that's a busy slide. I'll go through it quickly, but so that's the very general question of what is the origin of cosmic magnetic fields. So it's a complex question, in a few slides, in one slide, I will summarize what we know. So there are a lot of theories about the place, I picked only a few. The idea is that at the end of the realization, which happens 1 billion years after the Big Bang, the light from UV stars creates microscopic currents that seeds through a process, a plasma process called the Biermann battery, the universe with a very tiny magnetic field around 10 to minus 20 galaxies. So that's the starting point. Today, we see in those giant galaxies like this one, we see magnetic field of the order of a microgauss. So we have 14 orders of magnitude difference between the primordial seed from this Biermann battery and the galaxy we see today. Even more striking, we have observations of high redshift in absorption lines of quasars, where it seems that we see magnetic field which is 10 times larger than today. So the magnetic field was larger at early time than it is today, which is kind of the reverse way you would have thought. And the strength of the field seems to be increasing with increasing redshift, which is completely counterintuitive. So the classical theory for that is the so-called large scale dynamo, which is built on the existence of those large spiral galaxies which are amplifying the field through a large scale dynamo process. But the problem is that this process is very slow. So you don't have enough time with 13 gigahertz or barely enough time to have those 14 orders of magnitude. And if the fields are even higher at high redshift than today, then it's impossible. So, there is a history of galaxy formation energy simulation, quite recent, but didn't work. But very recently, a new generation of codes, and many of the authors are in this room, managed to do better simulation, higher resolution, and it seems that there is a new picture emerging, which is the so-called small-scale dynamo, which explains how the field gets amplified at high redshift, and I will argue here that it's because of supernova feedback. Okay, so let me demonstrate that to you. So what we did was to perform this numerical experiment of an isolated halo with gas cooling down onto a disk. And without feedback, what you form is a thin, relatively thin, clumpy disk, which is spiral wave. And this rotates forever, for many, many gigahertz. And you have the same disk here, but with supernova feedback on. And what you see is a mess, so the same picture as before, with this galactic fountain. The gas is going up and down, like a giant washing machine. And this highly turbulent flow is maintained for many, many times by the supernova feedback. So now we model this galaxy with ideal MHD, we solve the ideal MHD equation, just starting from a very weak field as initial condition. And what do we find? Well, in the no feedback case, we find very weak amplification of magnetic energy as a function of time, and this is basically consistent with an amplification due to the rotation, so the field lines are sheared. It's a linear growth rate with time, so the energy scale as time, basically. So that's what you see, it's a log curve. The y-axis is in log and the x-axis is in linear. And now, with supernova feedback, you see this very significant exponential growth of the magnetic energy. So you clearly have a dynamo, a very strong dynamo, which is occurring in this giant washing machine, which is our dwarf galaxy, being steered by supernova feedback. And so this clear exponential growth is strikingly different between the two models, where you have no exponential growth on the left, and you have a strong exponential growth on the right. So what we did was to gauge the effect of resolution, so that's the blue curve at the bottom here. So we changed the resolution between factors of two, and the no feedback case see no significant change in the magnetic energy amplification, the function of time. You just have fluctuations due to the formation of clumps. But the magnetic energy doesn't grow globally. With the feedback case, on the other hand, we see always an exponential growth, but the growth rate is faster at higher resolution. Right? And that's a clear signature of a small-scale dynamo. So one point to have in mind also is that if you don't have a good enough resolution, then the magnetic energy will not grow, So you need a critical resolution to see this small scale diagram. And in our case, we need roughly 100 resolution elements throughout the supernova-driven corona to be able to see this diagram. But if you have enough resolution, then you see an exponential growth, and the faster the growth, the higher the resolution. And this is completely consistent with the small scale diagram picture, where the amplification is due to the smallest eddies you have in your turbulent flow. And so the better the resolution, the smaller your eddies, and the faster the growth rate. So now, obviously, we are interested in studying the saturation of the dynamo. So what happens now if you start with a field which is not vanishingly small, like we did before, in the kinematic regime? Now you're studying the saturation regime, and you see that the magnetic energy grows at different resolution, and then saturates at the value which, if you now plot the kinetic energy power spectrum in red and the magnetic energy power spectrum in blue, saturates at the level which is 1% of the kinetic energy. And so that's what we find. So it does not saturate at so-called equipartition, so the magnetic energy is not equal to the kinetic energy at saturation, it's only 1%. And so we found it was a surprise, it's wrong. But actually when we look at our colleagues here, Ralph Cresson and collaborators, they have studied the same saturation level as a function of various flow parameters, like the Mach number or the proton number. And actually we realize that in this galaxy, we are completely in the regime where you expect a 1% saturation level. In our case, the proton number is of the order of 1, so we have 1% in this case. And the Mach number in our galaxy is of the order of a few, in a compressive forcing due to this large-scale fontaine. And so this 1% efficiency in terms of saturation is completely explained by the theory of small-scale dynamo and supported by other people. So now, what is the result of that? What is the final word for this dynamo? So basically, at high redshift, you have dwarf galaxies which are completely dominated by supernova feedback. Very quickly, almost instantaneously, you reach saturation. Actually, you don't need, you need to wait for the turbulent cascade driven by supernovae to develop enough, and then immediately you reach the saturation level. And the key point is that the saturation level is probably not at equipartition. It's probably at 10% of equipartition. Right? So what is interesting is that if you work out simple numbers using the basic, very well-known cosmological halo properties, you see that the equipartition field scales with mass and redshift using the scaling law, very simple. And actually, it shows that for a given halo mass, the magnetic field at equipartition is higher at high redshift. That's because the potential well of halos are deeper at high redshift, so the turbulence is higher. So that's completely in line with some observational constraints. So what happens now today? That's a big question, because today we don't have those turbulent galaxies. Today we have a grand-design spiral, very thin disk. So there is a transition from this high redshift feedback messy universe dominated by feedback, and today at low redshift, grand design spiral with very thin disk, much more quiet. So this transition is probably due to some poorly understood transition of feedback processes. I'm not trying to enter this game here, but what we did actually in our simple experiment is we turned off feedback after a couple of giga years, and then what we obtained is again a very thin disk where all the free energies are now in equipartition. Because of the collapse of this corona, so this supernova-driven corona, when we turn off feedback, by hand, in our case, we end up with a thin disk, in which now the magnetic energy, the thermal pressure, and the turbulent energy are more or less in equipartition. And so that's the picture that probably we need to confirm, that, for example, using cosmological simulation, is that the equipartition field we see in the galaxy today is the result of this two-phase dynamo, one driven by feedback at high redshift. And then, when the galaxies settle into thin disk, a compression phase where you reach finally equipartition. So, that's maybe one interesting prediction of these simulations using strong supernova feedback. Okay, so now let's move to larger galaxies. So, larger galaxies, these are a few equations here, very simple equations. Which kind of demonstrate that supernova feedback is probably not working for large galaxy mass. Why is that? So what we did here was to consider a supernova explosion that propagates an adiabatic shock, so energy conserving shock, inside the nuclear cloud. And then you can compute what is the velocity of the cloud when it's exploded by the supernova. And if you use reasonable parameter, you find that the cloud velocity, in a very optimistic case here, because you assume it's energy conserving, is 90 km per second. And there is no way this gas, which is in this exploding molecular cloud, can be unbound from the Milky Way. For a dwarf galaxy, that's higher than the escape velocity. For a dwarf galaxy, it's fine. But for the Milky Way, the escape velocity is much, much higher because the potential wave is much deeper. So this gas will fall back into a galactic fountain. And it's very hard to regulate star formation if you don't have a higher velocity. So then, what people have thought is to tap into another source of energy, which is the radiation energy from OB stars, so the UV radiation, so that's the luminosity, so the energy released by radiation, compared to the energy released by supernova. So if you can absorb this radiation and transfer it into momentum, then you have 100 times more energy into radiation than into supernova. The key point is how do you do this absorption of radiation? Then you need to absorb the UV by the dust. And this is not an efficient process because galaxies are not that opaque. Right? So nevertheless, people consider this as a very serious source of feedback energy. So that's an example of a work from the FIRE project by Hopkins et al. And you can see here the star formation rate as a function of time in one of those galaxies. So no feedback at all, you have a very large star formation rate. And if you just include supernovae, you have the red curve here, so you reduce it a little bit. But now if you include radiation feedback from these stars, you reduce it significantly. And then if you include both, then you end up with a very small star formation rate, which is what you observe. So these people clearly convey the message that the radiation from UV stars significantly suppress star formation in those large galaxies where supernovae alone barely do the job. So we try to do that using a very simple model. So basically it's a model based on we dump all the radiation energy into a cell multiplied by an escape probability, so it's very, very cool. And then if the cell absorbs the entire energy from the stars, the luminosity from the stars, then you can work out the same model and reach much higher, obviously, escape velocity. So we played this game by varying the only parameter we have, which is the dust opacity here, kappa I bar, the dust opacity, which, as you can see from the previous plot here, is of the order of a few centimeters square per gram for realistic environments. Right? And so we played with this by modeling galaxies with different values for kappa I bar. And this is what we obtain, so that's the gas distribution of a cosmological disk without feedback at all, so it's a very thin disk with a satellite here, with supernovae only, so you have this small galactic fountain, so the gas is ejected at, say, 100 km per second and fall back immediately. But now if you use 5 for the opacity, you have this galactic wind, which is very strong, and then the stronger the opacity, I mean the higher the opacity, the stronger the effect, and you completely suppress star formation. And so now we can really, as a function of this parameter, which is the gas opacity, we can regulate the amount of star we have in our halo. So that's performance matching, so that's no feedback, supernova feedback, and then if you increase the opacity, you decrease the amount of star in your galaxy. Right, so it's great, it's working well. You can also explain the distribution of metals around halos, inside halos, so this is measurements of the oxygen 6 metal fraction as a function of radius in nearby halos. And all those lines are for various opacities. And the one that works the best is the violet line, which corresponds to a very large opacity of 50 centimeters per hour. So 10 times more than is allowed by a normal dust model. That's the only one that works. Okay? So now, what happens in terms of the galaxy morphology, and that's the big caveat of this project, is that that's, so what you see here is the stellar map, so that's the map of the stellar light, if you want. And the no feedback case is a very thin, actually beautiful disk, but wrong. The supernovae only case, you have a disk which is much dimmer, you have no bulge. But then, if you move to high opacity, you start to get spheroids. And the extreme case, you won't even see it, it's an elliptical galaxy. So you see that there is a morphological transformation of the galaxy, depending on how strong the feedback is. And that's a very bad news, because it means that we cannot maintain the spiral shape of nearby spirals together with their stellar content. Right? So if we manage to reduce the stellar content to the observed value down here, then it means in the same time we destroy the spiral shape and create a spiral. So clearly this is probably due to the modeling that we use, which is very naive and very true. And other groups find different results. So it's very sensitive to how you implement radiative feedback, and our implementation is arguably very naive. So now I want to switch to a more consistent implementation of radiative transfer, which is to actually solve the radiative transfer equation. So you know, we're brave, we say, okay, let's do that. You just have to solve this equation, which describes the intensity of radiation as a function of space, angular distribution, and time, and of course frequency. If you want to do this brute force, you have, for example, the Monte Carlo method that does that, then usually it's very slow and very hard to couple to the hydrodynamics. So we want to do radiation together with the hydrodynamics. Radiation, hydrodynamics. And so for that, we use the moment method, where basically we average the specific density over the angle. You've seen that in Astrophysics 101. And then you end up with two equations, one about the radiation energy depending on the radiation flux, the first moment, and the radiation flux depending on the radiation pressure tensor, the second moment, and so on and so forth. So you have an infinite hierarchy of moment, where on the right hand side you see all the absorptions due to the microscopic process. And of course, these moments equations are coupled to hydrodynamics through the cooling and heating term, and also to the radiation force, which converts momentum from the radiation to the gas. So this is great, right? Except that, what about this pressure tensor? We don't have an equation for the pressure tensor, right? And so we need a closure relation, and the approximation we use is the so-called M1 approximation. It's basically an approximation proposed by Laborer in the 80s, which gives an explicit form for the pressure tensor, which depends directly on the energy and the flux through this small f parameter. So I don't want to enter the details. The key take-home message here is that this pressure tensor is an explicit function of the two other moments. So we close completely the system. Basically, what we assume is that at every point, the radiation can be fitted by a dipole. So it's a pretty brutal approximation. The parameters of the dipole are basically determined using the total energy in the dipole and the flux in the direction of the dipole. So then, as soon as we have this closure relation, then we can close the system and design a method to solve the radiation hydrodynamics equation. And that's what we have done. I'm going to skip the numerical details here. If you're interested, you can look at those papers. So we have performed a lot of tests. For example, this Strongen sphere test, where at low density, if you include or not the radiation pressure, you don't see any effect, right? So that's the density inside the Strongen sphere. So it's a low density bubble propagating into a denser environment. Now, at higher density, so that's typical of ultra-compact H2 region, you see that if you don't include radiation pressure, you completely underestimate the size of the region. So that's a regime where radiation hydrodynamics is really important. Very briefly, I will show you a very preliminary simulation of a giant molecular cloud where we basically simulate the formation of stars, and you see the ionizing radiation coming from the stars here, which is heating up the gas around and feeding back onto the environment by destroying the filaments inside the molecular cloud and slowly evacuating the gas. You see a runaway star here in the scene. And at the end, you have this leftover gas, which is completely destroyed by radiation. So we use this technique to model an entire galaxy, of course at much lower resolution than the previous simulation, obviously. But now we have five photon groups, an infrared photon group, an optical UV for H1, UV for HE1 and HE2. So all these photon groups are used to more or less sample the spectrum with only five groups, it's not a lot. We model all those processes into this isolated galaxy. And So we compared the simulation with radiation. So you see that's the radiation field here, which is represented by the photoionization rate. And you see the striking effect here is that you see the stars, the star cluster, which are blinking. So it's a very stochastic process. It's depending a lot of time. It's a transient effect. And this blinking field is heating up the gas. That's the main effect here. And change quite significantly the morphology of the gas inside this disk, mostly and quite exclusively because of photoionization heating. So we compare, like our, the group I report the result, the fire simulation, we compare the star formation rate as a function of time, using or not supernovae or radiation. And actually, what we find is that we find a similar effect, which is that supernovae alone, which is this blue curve here, is not enough to regulate the star formation rate. Radiation alone, which is the yellow curve, is also not enough, but if you combine the two, then you see that we get this lower, self-regulated star formation system. The key difference with our colleagues is that it's not at all due to radiation pressure or radiation momentum, it's only due to the heating due to the UV radiation from the stars. And we find that there is absolutely no effect on the radiation pressure. So clearly, there is something fishy here. One big caveat we have in our simulations, obviously, is that our resolution is 10 parsec, meaning that it's bigger than a typical H2 region. Right? So that's a problem when we want to model H2 regions. And so, although we do things much more self-consistently, we are obviously limited by resolution, like in any simulation, right? So that's why it's a big caveat. I'm gonna skip this. Actually, I'm not gonna skip this. So we did a very big simulation recently of the same physics, so ionization and stars, except on a much larger scale, and what we are interested in is the cosmic ionization. So we did this gigantic simulation using the GPUs of the Titan supercomputer. It's actually a very large simulation. It's actually competitive compared to pure N-body simulations, except it's radio plus radiation radiolarian simulation. So it's quite extreme. And why can we do that? Because we use the GPU to do the radiation. And what you see here is the ionization fraction in the universe, which is slowly creeping and filling up the entire universe here, actually in our box. And one striking feature again is that galaxies are blinking. So that's because the star formation rate is off and on, so it's really the same breathing mode that we have in our dwarf galaxy earlier. And because of that, the gas is recombining, and then photoionized again, recombining again, and this was completely absent from the other simulation. So it's really a new feature, which is because we can do this radiation radiolarian. And so now if you compare our simulation, which is the black line, to observational constraints, so that's the neutral fraction that you see in quasar absorption line, the function of redshift, and that's the Planck optical depth. Actually, we are short, and that's because our escape fraction, the UV escape fraction from galaxies, turned out to be too low. What we did was we kind of roughly corrected it from that, and we managed to fit this corrected model using the red color now. And you see that it's borderline compatible with the Planck data. But actually, 2 weeks ago, we had the new Planck data, which gave the new optical depth, which is this marker of ionization. And actually, now the new data have significantly evolved down. And now there is a nice consistent picture between quasar absorption line and the CNE optical depth. And our model, like many others, are able to fit this. So the key parameter in this business of cosmic ionization is the escape fraction of the UV light outside of dwarf galaxies. And it's a parameter when you deal with these gigantic boxes. But you can actually model individual galaxies, dwarf galaxies, like the one I showed you before, and compute the escape fraction of the UV radiation going out of this messy turbulent gas. And that's what Kim and Chen did using the same code. And you can see that it's a very transient effect, the escape fraction, it's the black line here. And the dashed line is the average, the photon average escape fraction, which is of the order of 10%, which is actually what you need in order to explain cosmic randomization. Okay, so that was the rotational thermodynamics, what we can do now in cosmology. And it's quite exciting because it opens a lot of possibilities. Obviously, oscillations are very expensive and need to be optimized. And of course, there is always the caveat that resolution is never good enough. So now if we move to larger scales, it's the era of AGN feedback. And so you can see here a galaxy cluster. So now each of these little dots is a Milky Way galaxy. And in the center, we have a giant elliptical. So if you don't have AGN feedback, which is the result of these upper panels here, then what you form is a galaxy which is 10 times bigger than any galaxy you have in the universe. You have a gigantic gas disk, which does not exist in the universe. And the dark matter halo is completely transformed into a spheroid. And this is not what we see in the universe. So if you turn on AGN feedback using a standard recipe, one of them invented by Fokker here, then everything becomes much more in agreement with observations. You have a much dimmer central galaxy. You don't have disks anymore, but mostly ellipticals. And the dark matter halo remains oblate. So if you look at this recent simulation that was done by the team in Paris, you and Dubois and collaborators, you can see that without AGN feedback, you have very dense filaments with a lot of gas accumulating at the center of the halos. But with AGN feedback, you blow the gas out of the halo in these blue shaped shocks that you see at very large distances away from the halo. And all this gas, which would have accumulated and cooled catastrophically in the center, has been ejected outside of the halo. And so, quantitatively, what you can show is that the stellar mass inside the halo, as a function of the halo mass, the so-called abundance matching plot that we have seen many times already, is reduced by a factor of 10 if you use AGN feedback and goes into the observational points. Actually, this requires, of course, careful calibration of your AGN feedback model. Right? It's not magic here. It's the model that is calibrated to obtain this. Right? So there is no real, there is not a very strong predictive power, I would say. But at least we have this node that can alleviate this dramatic effect otherwise. So, same thing here, you see that that's the result from the first Illustris simulation, where you see in red the stellar mass inside the halo compared to observations. And what is more interesting is the green curve, which is the gas mass in the halo. And you see that in this simulation, way too much gas has been removed from the halo into the AGN. And actually, we have an opposite problem in our simulation. We don't remove enough gas in the AGN. So all those models, they are usually calibrated to reproduce the stellar mass. And then we see what we get from that. Right? And actually, you need to use more sophisticated model to bring these other observations back into agreement. So anyway, the message here is that all those simulations depends a lot on parameters. And it's hard to find the right value for these parameters. It's a complicated calibration procedure. The same approach is to consider that those are poorly known. Right? So then, how do we parameterize this effect if now we want to predict the power spectrum that I showed before, which was so accurately computed by n-body codes? But now, if you have those gigantic explosions pushing gas out in the AGN, what is the effect on the power spectrum? Right? And so, in a recent paper with Howard Schneider, what we did was to actually use n-body simulations and to modify, to basically displace the particle of this n-body simulation, trying to mimic the mass distribution modification due to all these baryonic effects. So, for example, here on the left, you have the density as a function of radius for the total mass. So the black line is the pure n-body profile, the so-called NFW profile. And the red line is what you have if you include, in a very simple way, a model for baryonic effects. So you have the central galaxy in the center, then you have a hot halo, and then you have ejected gas here in this tail, which is due to AGN feedback, pushing the gas outside of the halo. And so if you combine this, you can compute a displacement field, which is these blue arrows here, and we apply this displacement field to the n-body data to obtain a modified n-body data set due to this, of course, spherically symmetric, baryonic models. So it's a small displacement, a few percent, but it's enough to encode a model of baryonic effect. And so what do we get now? We plot the power spectrum of the modified emission divided by the power spectrum of the original emission, where we get the blue curve. So you have this huge deficit of power in these scales, right, which are the scale of interest for dark energy emissions. And where does it come from? Well, it comes from part from the ejected gas, which is the light blue line. So this deficit is because we have removed a lot of gas outside of the halo. You have also a significant contribution from the adiabatic relaxation of the dark matter halo, because you have removed this gas, so the dark matter has to relax to a more expanded state. So it's adiabatic expansion, if you want. And you see that the dark matter has lost a lot of power because of that. And then, to a minor level, the contribution from the central galaxy, which is the green and the hot gas. So the main effect here, this deficit of power that you see, is mostly due to the ejected hot gas together with the dark matter relaxation to this ejected gas. So how does it compare to other simulations, to the simulation I mentioned at the beginning? So that's the power spectrum with gas compared to the original dark matter only simulation. And this is the illustrious case. You see this large deficit of power due to this ejected gas. This is the Cosmo Hall simulation. And this is the most recent version of Cosmo Hall, which is Eagle. And you see the difference, it's huge. Right? So it's supposedly the same physics, but implemented differently, calibrated differently, and you have a huge difference in the prediction on how baryonic physics affect the total mass power spectrum. So clearly, one way to go is to understand what we're doing here and try to agree on what is the best model. Okay? But there's another way to go is to actually build these as three parameters. So we have one parameter, which is the ejected gas mass, which is encoded in this simple parameter, and another parameter, which is how far this ejected gas goes, the ejected values. And then by playing with those parameters, we can get different results. And then the idea is that we leave those as three parameters, and we try to fit the data by leaving those as three parameters. So we fit the cosmological parameters, omega dark matter, dark energy parameter, together with those parameters which encode the physics of baryons. And this is actually a nice plot that Orange Schneider recently did. So this is the correlation function of the DES 2015 data release in red, normalized multiplied by theta here. Those are computed correlation functions by varying those baryonic physics parameters, so the mass here and the ejected radius here. And you see that you can actually change a little bit the shape of this correlation function. So it's unclear whether we improve anything here. The error bars are quite large, but clearly Euclid or LSST will do much better than that. And clearly we will be able to see if there is an effect in this measurement. Okay, so those are my conclusions. So pure n-body models are, I would say, 1% accurate, but we need to go better than that. And the question is, can we do better? Actually, we can use more principles, but there are also some systematic effects in the n-body code, so we need to understand. Supernova feedback is actually very useful, as I showed, to change the distribution of mass in dwarf galaxies. And also, it's an interesting mechanism to explain the growth of the cosmic magnetic field in these feedback-dominated galaxies. Now, I think we are in the era of radiation hydrodynamics. So thanks to a lot of different codes being developed in a lot of different groups, we can now do radiation hydrodynamics simulation by deformation. It's quite mind-blowing, I think. And then, on larger scale again, agent feedback rules everything. We have a lot of models which can explain observations if they are properly calibrated. But now, we probably need to understand qualitatively how they work and use these as three parameters to be able to explore the dark universe. Thank you very much.
So, thank you very much, Juan, for
talk. Open for questions. No questions. Everybody is more wanting to go to a football match. Sure. My question is about the radiation pressure, because I don't believe that this is an important aspect, because usually when you absorb a UV photon, it is re-emitted in the infrared, and then typically the optical depth is very small, so it is just loss. So, if you take, let's say, frequency-dependent radiation transport into account, then I think this becomes an obvious process. So, can you explain why, for instance, fire then comes up with this horrendously strong radiation pressure?
So the plot I've shown from their paper is actually an old paper. It's probably 1 year old. It's a relatively old paper. They clearly show in this paper that you need radiation pressure, at least the way they implemented it, in order to get a strong enough feedback that allow the self-regulation of star formation. Now, it seems they changed their mind. And now what they are doing is to modify the superwave feedback. And now they don't need this infrared radiation pressure anymore. So the message here is that feedback processes are very complicated, and you can calibrate them in many different ways. And of course, the predictive power is not as high as some people claim or used to. So clearly, I think we are in a regime where we need to understand better even what supernova feedback is doing. And so I completely agree with you. I don't believe that infrared radiation should do much, except maybe at the scale of molecular cores, where it plays a role in setting up the IMF and so on and so forth. But having exploding clouds because of infrared radiation, I don't believe.
I was very impressed with your magnetic field generation results in galaxies, and I think that we're missing an important aspect of feedback process in not thinking harder about what magnetic fields are going to do to suppress fragmentation of the gas now that you've got very good results with very powerful fields. I mean, magnetic fields enter in many ways. They reduce the compression of gas when you have shocks, so that would, you know, prevent very high densities, we could fragment the stars, and there's a rather long list. I wondered if you'd thought about the possible roles of magnetic fields in these galaxies and the regulation mechanism for the star formation events.
There are many people, even in this room, who are considering these magnetic fields as a very serious player in the galaxy formation business. So clearly, it plays a role, possibly, in different aspects. So in the disk itself, it pressurizes the disk and regulates fragmentation. It also regulates at smaller scales, ISM down to star formation scales. It also probably plays a role in corona, where maybe we have much smaller things there. And also it plays a very important role when you couple it to cosmic rays. Christophe can back me up on this, but if you have cosmic rays that make it together, then cosmic rays can also do a lot. And clearly, a lot of groups are looking into this very seriously. The problem we have is that it's very hard to grow a field which is strong enough to enter this regime of a possible dynamical effect. And because it's very hard to see a dynamo, at least I find it very hard to see a dynamo, because you need this crazy high resolution, this critical resolution, to see the dynamo and be able to grow a field. So you can also inject field from explosions, but then it's not as clean, I would say. From the galaxy formation perspective, it's very hard to self-consistently form those very strong fields that we see in the universe. That's probably why, but now I think we are in a better position, and then we will start to see effects.
Further questions?
I just want to know whether AGMs can actually also drive a dynamo and actually make a magnetic.
So it's a possibility. So I think that there are many ways you you can have an effect of AGM to pump up magnetic field. For example, they can launch very strong shock in a turbulent medium, and this is a way to increase the field by by one or two orders of magnitude. So it's not a strong dynamo, but it increases the field each time you have a shock, and then turbulence decays and the field goes back to where it was, and then you have another shock goes up. So it's not really a dynamo, but it's, you can have an increased field strength just after the shock. Right? So that's clearly an effect that you can have with AGM. Now, AGM also, they have magnetized jets, and this also can create a channel where you increase the field inside the hot coronas. Now, maybe Christophe has other ideas, usually AGN are very rare, right, in the universe. So those are rare pieces, they will not do a lot. They do a lot when they are active, but then they go dormant, and then active again. So dwarf galaxies, in high energy universe, you have plenty of those. You have only dwarf galaxies everywhere. Right? So if you have a process that works in dwarf galaxies, then you're good, because you will fill all the dense gas with magnetic field. So that's a more promising effect. But AGM can do also a lot of magnetic field modification.
Question that I don't really understand. What's the physical mechanism why these magnetic fields are not growing until a partition but stop saturated below?
So it's a good point. Seriously, I was very unhappy about the non-ego partition value. So there are many explanations. One explanation is that when you have a compressive flow, you have magnetic loops, and then the flow becomes compressive, and then the loops reconnect and disappear. And so, in a compressive flow, in a compressive turbulence, you're constantly fighting against this. So the field wants to grow, does grow, and then there is a compressive mode that collapses, or the gas collapses, and then the field gets connected or disappears in very small scales. And, that's one explanation. There is another explanation related to the quantum number. So the quantum number measures the ratio of the viscosity, which in our case is to the magnetic dissipation, which in my case is also numerical. And since it's both numerical, the ratio of the two is one. Right? But in nature, you don't have numerical dissipation. Right? So you have the real microscopic process, and magnetic dissipation and viscous dissipation are not occurring necessarily at the same scale. And so if you have a separation of scale, it can actually allow for a higher magnetic and the level of saturation goes. Right? And that's what I was showing in this plot. So that it depends a lot on what's happening on the response space. Right? And so this quantum number of one probably means that you're constantly fighting against magnetic dissipation, and you can't get a partition because you always dissipate what you're trying to accumulate.
So would it then be even better to, on purpose, add a bit of extra dissipation in the magnetic and in the so that at least you can actually tune the quantum number yourself rather than letting the code do it for you.
It's true, so that's exactly what those simulations are doing. So these simulations here are somehow incorporating an explicit viscosity or an explicit magnetic diffusion so that they can come up with an explicit value for the quantum number. But here what you see is that if your quantum number is to the left part, then you expect very low saturation levels. Right? So what happens in nature is tricky to say, because the dissipation mechanisms are many, and it depends on the ionization state of the gas, so it's complicated. But the message is that you may be in a low saturation level, and then in order to reach a partition, you need something else, like a collapse into a thin disk. If you are already in a high saturation level, then you're fine. Then you're already fine, right? So the collapse will probably maintain you at the partition. So that was going to be my idea.
Maybe I can comment.
Of course, you are one of the authors.
So it depends on many things. Also, it depends on the mean magnetic field. That is, before Stryker has shown the kind of difference. think one also needs to look at the spectrum itself, because at very low speeds or high wave numbers, the magnetic field can actually be more than the kinetic energy. So this is an average value, and you need to look at the spectrum, the slope can vary dramatically in duration.
So there is also a caveat in our case, which is that we don't have a nice periodic box like here. We have a stratified galaxy, and things are different.
Okay, is there a further question? Or is it time for football? Okay, well, then let's thank Romain again for a nice talk.